Now the last presentation that we have is from the state of Kerala, and the presentation is being made by Nidhin, who is the hazard analyst with the state government. And I'm happy to see his presentation, which is forwarded to me, that he's not talking about the problems with the state faced during Oki, but they're focusing more towards what is it that the state has done to overcome whatever were the problems. And his presentation is focused primarily on the communication setup which they have at the state, district, and down to taluk level, and also with regard to their state emergency operation center, which is a state of art center which has been established. We would be happy to hear as to what decision support system you have and what is the way forward to make it into a model state emergency operation center. Over to you, Nidhin.
Thank you so much, sir, and respected chair and the co-chair and other dignitaries in the panel and in among the audience and the representatives from the state. It's an honor to represent the Kerala State Disaster Management Authority in the NDMA Formation Day, and I will just try to keep it as short as possible, as the chair has already mentioned. So I'll just look around the last mile dissemination and the vulnerability of Kerala coast in more particular, and the existing mechanism that we already have and the way forward. So I don't want to spend more time on the general slides, which already been explained very in detail and very scientifically by the other presenters before me. And so we already know that the early warning is a system which have so much important aspects in identification, detection, and risk assessment of the hazard, and accurate identification of vulnerability of the population at risk, everything. And I'm just concentrating on the Kerala coast because I represent the Kerala state government. So we have a 580 kilometer length coast with width around 35 to 120 kilometer, and we have 30% of the total population living in the coastal zone, and majority of them are fishermen. And the Kerala state is one of the most densely populated state and a coastal state for that sake, and we have total 33 million people as per 2011 census. And out of these 9 coastal districts in the state, 7 district headquarters falls in the coastal zone, and the 4 city corporations and 19 municipal towns and 150 villages are within the seashore border. And that poses, with the rapid urbanization and the very increasing population density, that poses more vulnerability for the coastal community, including fishermen. So the coastline is exposed to strong wind, high waves, storm surges, and tsunami. And these natural phenomena in turn results in rampant coastal erosion and consequent beach loss. And looking at the geometry or the landscape of Kerala state, it's very evident that the land availability for the reconstruction and for the rehabilitation of the fishermen community is very limited, and it's highly challenging. And after the recent floods, the Kerala state government is really facing a challenge for the rehabilitation of the people, because we have a huge task ahead building the state better in a more sustainable manner. So, and the coastline and the coastal hazards and the cyclones poses a more threat on the multi-hazards that already Kerala is prone to. And with this map, it's clear that most of the hill areas in the Western Ghats are prone to landslides, and major 15% of the total geographical area is prone to flooding and other disasters. And we already declared the coastal erosion as a state-specific disaster in the context of the state of Kerala. And moving on to the last mile dissemination is one of the most highly challenging tasks we face in the early warning system. And the district emergency operations centers in each district and taluk control rooms in the taluk level are very operational to get this last mile connectivity and the last mile dissemination for the vulnerable communities on the field. And we have police wireless VHF system at the district control rooms and VSAT system to make a smoother communication facilities, and hotline facility available to contact police, fire and rescue teams, and Navy. And toll-free numbers are provided to public for contacting the district emergency operation centers. And as Jane sir mentioned in the inaugural address already, the understanding the potential of social media, WhatsApp, and Facebook Facebook platforms, we engage the public very regularly on our social media platforms, and we connect with the fisheries control room, the Department of Harbor, ports, and taluk control rooms on a regular basis to ensure the smooth communication between these different stakeholders. So coming on to the communication to fishermen at the deep sea, We already tested the NAVIC system that already mentioned by the Divagas sir, and it's a two-way communication system that will be more effective to get the output from the fisherman itself. And we tested the potential of early warning dissemination through medium wave channel of All India Radio, and it's found very effective till 150 nautical miles from the coast, and the Coast Guard ship ICGS Vikram assisted the state government to test the possibility of testing the potential of early warning system through medium wave. And it's a very low cost medium of disseminating the warnings and alert messages to the common fishermen people in the deep sea. So it's something that we really look forward to implement on a large scale basis. So we do have an existing mechanism of early warning system in the State Emergency Operations Center of our State Disaster Management Authority. So we collaborated with IBM for an intelligent operations center solution that integrates and uses data from various sources like IMD and INCOIS and makes sense of a single and in a local language that can be understood by the common people. So VSAT and satellite phone communication for the district collectors in the vulnerable districts. And as I already mentioned, the social media platforms are very active and very effective for the dissemination of early warnings. And this is a scenario right now. We have a state emergency operation center at the state level. We work very closely with the IMD, INCOIS, and other scientific advisory bodies to disseminate warnings to the district emergency operation center. And then through the district emergency operation center, they control the activities at the taluk control rooms. So there is the synergy between the ground level control rooms and the district level control rooms and the various multiple stakeholders at the different departments and the different nodal agencies is the key for a smooth and well coordination between these departments. So State Emergency Operations Center is hand-holding all these activities at the state level. So we do have a very comprehensive scientific platforms for the vulnerability assessment and risk assessment and for capacity building of the fishermen at the vulnerable areas. And we additionally have 7 predictive models which we use for the disaster hazard vulnerability assessment. And for looking forward to the way forward, the following systems are proposed for State Emergency Operations Center and respective District Emergency Operations Center: a unified notification system for dissemination of alerts that already been mentioned by the chair in the inauguration of this technical session. And all the alert systems devices can be collectively managed, activated, and monitored from a single unified easy to use interface. And it's again a common alert protocol used and enabled with the system for the CAP controllers. So this is the flow diagram that will be very well in place in a very short span of time. We'll incorporate the sources from information from various sources like IMD, INCOIS, ISRO, from NDMA, and in our Intelligence Operations Center, we'll disseminate the information through a unified alerting system in a very simple local language that will be pushed through various channels, multiple channels, including TV, media, social media, digital signage, media override, and other vulnerable communities in the field. And the mass messaging system that already been in place with the collaboration of DOT and CDOT. So we will integrate this mass messaging system with the IBM IOC and process the data and predict the vulnerable areas on GIS-based maps that can be pushed through the public, coastal communities, fishermen agencies, government officials, NGOs, and cyclone shelter committee, and ham radio operators. They also played a very vital role in the recent flood that happened. And to mention that the role of the fishermen communities also in the recent floods, they worked very closely with the state mechanisms, government mechanisms to rescue operations, and they are well in tandem with the state mechanisms. So this is the other way forward for group alert and location-based mass messaging systems. So that's already in place, and we are looking forward to get more public, private service providers on board to make it more in a more broader manner. So there will be an audio messages will be given to the public and the fishermen community. So coming on a concluding point, we cannot ignore the fact that the global climate change is really accelerating the different complicated cyclonic systems, because in the past few years we have observed tremendous increase in the number of depressions forming in Arabian Sea and the Bay of Bengal. And I'm sure that under the leadership of NDMA and with the advancement in technologies from ISRO and IMD, we can really work in close collaboration for a better future and disaster resilient India and disaster resilient state. Thank you so much for this opportunity, and I really thank thank you so much.
Thank you, Nidhin. I think we need to compliment the state of Kerala for having taken few initiatives post Oki, and within a span of 10 to 11 months, they have been able to establish very robust system, particularly to address the problem of dissemination of information by having emergency operation center down to taluk level. Before I throw the house open for inviting questions, I request my co-chair to share his views on the subject and also sum up the session per se.
Thank you, Marwa sir. In fact, at the outset when we started off today with the minister here, Mr. Jain was also addressing that point. I have been just seeing the way forward of the NDMA. It has started having an octopus presence from a standalone institutional presence. In the sense, it has started integrating with almost all the state of the art, modern simulation practices with the army, with the NDRF, with the satellite, with the everything. I think now we are getting more into the system thing. Now coming on to the first speaker, our Ramesh ji who spoke. In fact, today we have realized one thing, that it is not the EWS, that is the early warning system, which is also important. There is also some other terminology called CEWS, that's the community early warning system. EW warning system is a formal system in which we go on giving warning messages, formalization through radio, through satellite, through the channels and other thing. But when it is passed on and translated into action, it has to be the CEWS. And that would need a lot of volunteer training, identification of people, FM stations to gear up and back up and all those things. It has to be part of the whole package. Otherwise, just EMS, EWS will not be able to help. And when he started off with the saying that he's only for the deep sea fishing, but I think more or less with the multi-predictive models that have been developed by the weather system people, we can also be able to now predict more on the Uttarakhand and the Himachal kind of prototype experiences in the future, so that people are now also geared up the EWS and the CEWS, which can be a part of the model. It's not only for deep sea. Deep sea is now becoming definitely now 80%, 20% is also the landmass problem, multi-predictive models, which has to be incorporated. The second point I wanted to mention about Mr. Divakar, when he was talking of the NAVIC model, my own experience in the field says that we have to, particularly the people who are in the field, means the practitioners, administrative people, 3-4 things we have to keep in mind. One, the NMR, the National Marine Register. Each ship today is compelled to be a part of the National Marine Register. Number two, it has to be registered under the AIS, the Automatic Identification System. And that automatic identification system has to be only for those ships which are having 300 metric tons and up. They have to be part of it. None of us, we are never of it. We never meet. The question is that if we are particularly on these two things, if we are doing our homework well, I'm sure we'll be able to regulate it, control them, guide them at the port entry point, that is through the port department as to how many have gone out and how many have gone in, or how many are on stranded on the way, so that our own ocean system, like first 3 kilometers is the police, from 3 kilometers to 10 kilometers is our coast guard, and from 10 kilometers onwards is the Navy. So we'll be able to spot accordingly, go for the rescue, relief and other things. This is something which I wanted to mention here. And another point I also wanted to mention when Mr. Divakar was talking, see, there is a Bluetooth connectivity with the NAVIC software which he is talking of. But let me tell you, most of the fishermen, they make it off. They will try to make it off in order to get out into the more economic and very rich waters, which are could be on the international border, and they will not be detected in those things that you are already crossed that thing. They want to make more money This is, I'm telling you, which is a practical thing which is happening. And when they get into those things, they make it off. So I was always trying to suggest to Mr. Diwakar, can this NAVIC be dovetailed with the AIS system? Automatically, he cannot make it off. So that he'll be caught red-handed if he is trying to tamper with it. That was number two. Number three point I wanted to mention was that the we have to have preparedness also for this kind of ravages and damages, all this we have been having in Himachal and Uttarakhand. And that is because of the fact that we have to now go with a massive regeneration, restoration of the forest area, because all we saw in the televisions were only dirt and this dust coming out, and NDRF being NDRF getting troubled, SDRF getting troubled on toes all the time, but just because we have not been able to have the other things which in there. The another I wanted to mention was that the Kerala experience which was narrated. In fact, I have very closely watched Kerala. Kerala density of population has helped Kerala. The houses are so near each other. Your early warning system by the our agencies, multi agencies, and